this evening. I'm so glad that you've chosen to come out and be a part of this service this evening. Certainly, our prayer is that this will be not just meaningful, but that this will be significant in your spiritual life as we prepare for the season of Lent, the 40 weekdays that lead up until Easter, a time when we're encouraged to reflect and to repent, to do self-examination, and many other things that we'll be talking about in the service. If you're visiting with us tonight, just know that we're so glad that you've chosen to worship with us. I want to point out one thing in the bulletin. If you'll look on the inside second page where it says imposition of ashes, and it says also at this time, please bring forward your sheet of paper to be placed in the basket. Yeah, ignore that. We're not doing that tonight. Everything else in the bulletin we're going to be doing this evening. So thank you once again for coming. May God bless you. May God encourage you through this service of worship.
may be seen not by others, but by your Father who is in secret. And your Father who sees in secret will reward. Do not store up for yourself treasures on earth, where moth and rust consume, and where thieves break in and steal. But store up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust consumes, and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also.
Or will be again after that in ages to come. now, says the Lord, return to me with all your heart, with fasting, with weeping, and with mourning. Rend your hearts and not your clothing. Return to the Lord your God, for he is gracious and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and relents from punishing. Who knows whether he will not turn and relent and leave a blessing behind him, a grain offering and a drink offering for the Lord your God. Blow the trumpet in Zion, sanctify a fast, call a solemn assembly, gather the people. Sanctify the congregation, assemble the aged, gather the children, even infants at the breast. Let the bridegroom leave his room and the bride her canopy. Between the vestibule and the altar, let the priests, the ministers of the Lord, weep.
Good evening.
Good evening.
I'm Pastor Julia Hayes. I'm one of the associate pastors here, and I have the privilege of speaking to you all today. Would you join me now in prayer? Holy and loving God, thank you for gathering us together today as your people. Lord, this is a hard day. Thank you that you are here with us in the midst of it. Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Just about 3 years ago at this time, I had a pastoral first, which is that I had a chance to impose ashes on a congregation for the first time. With almost every other pastoral milestone like this, the first time I've done something, it has been a source of great joy and excitement and reverence. But I hated imposing ashes. Over and over, the congregants came forward. These were people that I loved. People who had opened their hearts and their homes to me for the past 6 months as their field education intern from Duke Divinity School. And now here I was as each one of them came forward, looking them in the eyes, rubbing these burnt leaves on their foreheads and telling them, you are dust, and to dust you will return. I didn't want them to be dust. I wanted them to be eternal and unchanging and unstoppable. I couldn't stand to imagine a world without Miss Rose's cherry trifle or Mr. Boone's laughter. It was already just about more than I could handle. And then a man came forward who had been recently diagnosed with a terminal illness. And I had to take his gaunt, bony face in my hands and mark him with ashes. Placing my fingers on him, it felt absurd. He knew he was dying. Did I literally have to rub it in his face? And then a six-year-old girl came forward, her smile just as big as her bow in her hair. And I had to crouch down to this little girl full of life and giggles and smiles and tell her that one day she was going to die. It feels rude, even offensive, to talk about the reality of death. And really, our culture has been set up to help us avoid death as much as we possibly can. We like to use euphemisms like, she passed away, instead of feeling those hard edges of the words, she died. When someone we love dies, we may never even see their body before it's sealed into a casket or cremated. But Lent is a time for telling the truth. We tell the truth about the truth is that we will die. As terrifying as facing our mortality is, we have to do it in order to get into right relationship with God. Our mortality reminds us that we are creatures and not the Creator. Our breath is not our own. It has been breathed into us by God. There's a worship song that I love that talks about this. It says, "It's your breath in our lungs, so we pour out our praise to you only." Or 1 Peter 1, verses 24 through 25 says, "All flesh is like grass, and all its glory like the flower of grass. The grass withers and the flower falls, but the word of the Lord endures forever." Facing our own mortality is one way that we can tell the difference between us and God. We also need to face our mortality to feel the weighty gift of eternal life offered to us in Jesus Christ. The 17th century preacher Thomas Watson said, "Until sin be bitter, Christ cannot be sweet." Well, until death is bitter, resurrection will not be sweet. We can't skip to Easter without the hard work of Lent. Before we can receive the hope of the resurrection, we must face the reality of death. Resurrection isn't a way around death. Resurrection is a way through death. As we tell the truth about our mortality, we also need to tell the truth about our limitations. Just like we have built things in our society to avoid death, we also have all sorts of ways to try to get around our very real human limitations. We have electric lights, so that now we aren't beholden to such pesky things as night and day. We have laptops, so that we can take our work wherever we go, even vacation. We have cell phones so that we can be constantly available to the people who might need us. Now, none of these things are inherently bad. I myself am certainly a fan of the comforts of modern living, particularly air conditioning and heating and electricity. But in this modern world, it is becoming harder and harder for us to see ourselves as the limited creatures that we are. I really hate admitting my limitations. In fact, I tend to find great ways to just deny them altogether. Here's an example. I have a nasty habit of being late. And most of the time when I'm late, it is because I have denied the reality of my limitations. You see, I know that the drive from my house to the church takes 35 minutes with no traffic. And that in the mornings, it's probably going to take 40 minutes. And yet, over and over and over again, I believe that it is only going to take me 30 minutes. Somehow, the limitations of time and space will not apply to me. If I can dream it, I can do it. And I dream that the drive will only take 30 minutes. Unfortunately, no matter how much I wish that they didn't, the laws of the universe apply to me too. I'm limited. And you are limited. You cannot stop your hair from turning gray or your bones from getting brittle. You cannot read enough books or listen to enough podcasts to have all of the answers. You cannot do so many Sudoku puzzles that you can guarantee you won't lose a single memory. You cannot put your kids into enough extracurricular activities that you can guarantee their happiness. And you cannot eat enough vitamin C gummies to be sure that you will never get a cold. than any human being can actually do is to try to put ourselves on the same level as God. And the church has a word for that. Idolatry. But when we confess our own limitations, we give glory to the God who is unlimited. When we rest, we give glory to the God who neither slumbers nor sleeps. When we say, I don't know, we give glory to the God who is truth. Lent is a time for telling the truth. Lent is also a time for repentance. Repenting is more than just admitting that you've done something wrong and feeling sorry for it. Repentance requires a change in behavior. The Greek word for repent is metanoia, which literally means to turn around. It means a change in behavior, a choice to go the opposite direction. What is it today that you need to repent of? What if the sin we need to repent isn't a failure to be more holy, but a refusal to admit our limitations? Where are you denying your limits? Maybe you need to repent of answering your work email late at night when you ought to be asleep. Maybe you need to repent of taking that extra dose of DayQuil and pushing through instead of admitting that you're sick and taking the rest your body needs. Maybe you need to repent of the compulsion to have an opinion on every possible topic and current event and to be sure that that opinion is right. For me, a practice of repentance is likely going to be leaving the house 45 minutes before I need to be at church. In a few moments, you'll come forward, and you'll have ashes painted on your foreheads, and someone will say to you, "You're dust, and to dust you will return." Don't shy away from it. You are human. And to be human is not a sin. You are limited. And you are loved. Let's pray. God, we really wish that we didn't have limits. We really wish that we were more like you. That our bodies didn't die. That we could do whatever we wanted to do. But Lord, we are so grateful to be your children. Thank you for your patience with us. Thank you that even when we forget that we are limited, you always remember. And you are filled with compassion. Help us in this season of Lent to remember how we were made and to live as you have called us to live, as creatures made by you, our Creator. We love you, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Our responsive reading this evening is found on page 785 in the back of your hymnal. We'll read through all 17 verses of Psalm 51, and I'll read the first part, and if you will follow with the whole. Have mercy on me, O God, according to your steadfast love.
According to your abundant mercy, blot out my transgressions.
Wash me thoroughly from my iniquity, and cleanse me from my sin.
For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me.
Against you only have I sinned, and done that which is evil in your sight, so that you are justified in your sentence and blameless in your judgment.
Behold, I was born into iniquity, and I have sinned.
Behold, you desire truth in the inward being. Therefore, teach me wisdom in my secret heart.
Purge me with hyssop, and I shall be clean. Wash me, and I shall be whiter than snow.
Make me hear with joy and gladness, let the bones which you have broken rejoice.
Hide your face from my sins, and blot out all my iniquities.
Create in me a clean heart, O God, and put a new and right spirit within me.
Cast me not away from your presence, and take not your Holy Spirit from me.
Restore to me the joy of your salvation, and sustain in me a willing spirit.
Then I will teach transgressors your ways, and sinners will return to you.
Deliver me from death, O God, God of my salvation, and my tongue will sing aloud of your deliverance.
O Lord, open my lips, and my mouth shall show forth your praise.
For you have no delight in sacrifice. If I give a burnt offering, you would not be pleased.
The sacrifice acceptable to God is a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise.
Brothers and sisters, the early Christians observed with great devotion the days of our Lord's passion and resurrection. And it became the custom of the church that before the Easter celebration, there should be a 40-day season of spiritual preparation. And during this season, converts to the faith were prepared for holy baptism. It was also a time when persons who committed serious sins and had separated themselves from the community of faith were reconciled by penitence and forgiveness, and restored participation in the life of the church. In this way, the whole congregation was reminded of the mercy and forgiveness proclaimed in the gospel of Jesus Christ and the need we all have to renew our faith. So I invite you, therefore, in the name of the church, to observe the Holy Lent by self-examination and repentance, by prayer, fasting, and self-denial, by reading and meditating on God's holy word, to make a right beginning of repentance as a mark of our mortal nature. Let us bow before our Creator and our Redeemer this evening. Let us pray. Almighty God, you have created us out of the dust of the earth. Grant that these ashes may be to us a sign of our mortality and penitence, so that we may remember that only by your gracious gift are we given everlasting life. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen. I invite you this evening to come forward to receive the mark of the cross as a symbol of our mortality and our repentance. And does everybody have a container? So here's what we'll do. Serve this area here, and Julia, if you'll serve this group, and David, if you'll serve that. We'll have the choir go first. So after the choir comes forward, if you will come forward. We're Methodists. We don't need ushers tonight. We like methods. We like order. So we'll just kind of go one pew at a time. I think we can probably figure that out. And as you come forward to receive the ashes, you can stay here at the chancel for a time of prayer, or return to your seat.
Thank you.
reminder of our frailty. Go today as those who know your limits. And as you go, may the Spirit of the living God made known to us most fully in Jesus Christ our Lord go before you to show you the way. Go behind you to push you into those places you might not go on your own. Go above you to watch over you and protect you. Go beneath you to lift you up when you cannot stand. Go beside you to be your companion and dwell within you to remind you every day